He started with the obedience, طاعات الله سبحانه وتعالى, and he said, اعلم أن أوامر الله فرائض ونوافل. The commands from Allah سبحانه وتعالى in the Holy Quran or by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, it's of two components. Some which is farad, an obligation, and the other one which is nafila. That means this is your choice or it's optional. You may do or you may not do. Okay? And he started to specify each one of them. He said, فالفرض رأس المال وبه تحصل النجاح. Yeah, this is like when you invest money, and the money that you put for investment, this is considered your obligation. Here, we trade in your investment or the asset given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is it? It is time, okay? You are given time. You are given the opportunity to practice, okay? When you practice your obligations, you know, in an accepted way, you have good bargain, you know, in this matter, okay? You have done well, you know, in the time. When you add on the top of it the optional or the nafila, again, you have done very well in this regard. You see, this is the way for those who are too materialistic, you know, to look at it, you know, in this regard, you know. The Prophet ﷺ highlighted the importance of the time and how we should get the maximum of our time. And this is our asset or our profit, you know, to start with, you know, in this regard, you know, is our time. والنفل هو الربح به والفوز بالدرجة. Okay, يعني the obligations, they are going to save you of punishment and make you free of any reckoning, you know, in the hereafter. Whereas a nafil, when you have on the top of it what we call it as an extra or more work, you know, of that regard, this is going to get higher and higher in the ranks of the heaven, you know. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described the ranks of the heaven by 100 rank, in each the difference or the distance between one rank and another is similar to the distance between the earth and the sky. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الله عز وجل. This is we call hadith qudsi. And the hadith qudsi, it's the word, it's derived from Allah. The structure was done by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. These are the words of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم speaking in behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for sure, by this you know that this is not Quran. This is not a miracle like the Quran. This is a message came right away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his messenger to ourselves, you know. And most of these ahadith speaks about Allah, speaks about the attributes of Allah, speaks about the actions of Allah. I think I mentioned it in the past when I tried to push hard, you know, to have everyone increase his knowledge in Allah and increase his love to Allah. I told you that one of the way to recite or to read al-ahadith al-qudsiyah, because most of them speaks about Allah, about his attributes, about his names, and you name it. That's why this was the first work, you know, to collect a hadith qudsiyah was done by Sufi. Why? Because they feel the need of it. It was done by Sheikh Al-Akbar, rahimahullah, is the first one to collect al-ahadith al-qudsiyah among everyone. Everyone who tried to collect is later than him, and he is the first one to do this. Why? We should ask ourselves, because he is one of the knowledgeable people in Allah, and he felt that one of the significant way of getting knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-ahadith al-qudsiyah. And here, in this particular hadith, which is famous, narrated by Bukhari and mentioned in Arba'in Nawawiyyah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us about how to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's no way to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better than perform your obligation. This may sound too simple and quite obvious, and no need to talk about it. I'm telling you, we have significant lack nowadays. Okay, we do a lot of nafila and we waste our obligation. Okay, يعني you find the person, for example, he look for bay'ah, look for zikr, look to attend majlis of mawlid, and you name it. All these matters, they are very good, you know. And in the meanwhile, he has haram money, you know, with him. He may backbite someone, he is misbehave with this person or that person. And here, really we live this problem nowadays, you know. Most of us, we give the maximum interest for these matters, which are great, and we bypass what is more important than them, which is the obligation or the prohibition. You see, and this is, for me, doesn't mean a lot, you know, because here I'm wasting what is important and try to cover, you know, with other matters, which is optional. And they said those people who are knowledgeable in Allah. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said here in this hadith, the best thing, you know, to get closer to Allah is the obligation, and this, the nafila comes later on. Why? Because of the nature of both of them. What do you mean by the nature? When you are obliged to do something, or you are obliged not to do something, this is show that you are slave to Allah. You don't have any choice. You cannot say, I would do or I would not do. Okay? Ramadan, you cannot say, I'm going to break my fast during Ramadan. When Shawwal starts, no one has the authority to tell you that you are obliged to fast. You see the difference? So here, in obligation is the best way of expression of your slavery to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because you are human, you have intellect, you have intelligence, you have choice, no one can dictate anything of you, and all of a sudden you found yourself as a person without freedom, without options, without selection, and you are completely going by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. And this is the best way of showing your slavery to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Whereas in Nafila, I have my portion. What do I mean I have my portion? I may start or not. When I start, I may pray two or four. When I make zikr, I may make 100 or 1,000. When I want to interrupt, I'm going to interrupt and speak with my friend. And when I want to eat, even during Ramadan, according to during fasting, outside Ramadan, according to some scholars, you may interrupt, you know, and you name it. All these matters give you the option, okay, that you may do or not. When you may have this, you have a piece of freedom. Here in the Nafila, you don't show that you are real slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you have the optional portion which joining you. Whereas in Fariza, in obligation, this is really the time to try to concentrate, try to pile up with yourself, you know, everything, you know, to make this one of the best performance in your life, because here you are going to completely, without exception, without portion, without anything, obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are going to have the full obedience of Allah. And no surprise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this particular hadith, you are not going to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by any way, at all, better than, or rather than, when you perform your obligation. And this should be put in all of our minds, okay? Don't try to look here and there before fixing your faraid, okay? And I'm telling you, I'm a bad person, that's why I had these bad thoughts about everyone. I see it, I observe it, you know. People, they look forward for bay'ah, look forward for zikr, look forward for this or that, you know. And I see and observe how they waste their obligation, how they bypass some of the prohibitions matters, you know. The Prophet ﷺ said, make it clear, إن الله فرض فرائض فلا تضيعها. الله سبحانه وتعالى put obligations, set an obligation, don't or obligation, don't waste them. وحد حدودا فلا تعتدوها. There's a border or something that you are prohibited to go, beyond it. So go, don't go beyond it. These are حدود الله. Allah سبحانه وتعالى said تلك حدود الله. About inheritance, okay? Now we have some people, they try to bypass inheritance. Really, I felt bad, you know. Once I was observing a woman from Tunisia, you know. She called herself free, you know, and started to speak up, you know, about this and that, you know, and many matters against Islam, and you name it, this Tunisian woman. And in her talk, she said that in Tunisia, this is the practice, so why you are ashamed of making the female equal to the male in their inheritance? This is the practice. In Tunisia, many people, you know, they try to go around and try to bypass the rule of Allah and write wasiyah for their children, you know, in their life. This is what she said, to write a wasiyah. And in this will, you know, they are going to divide their inheritance, you know, equally between males and females. So this is the practice. Why you are ashamed of it? Really, I feel bad when I hear this, you know, because if this is the case, that means many people, even though they believe in the rule of Allah, but they don't want to apply it. They want to apply something else. You see? And this is our stand in many occasions. We believe in everything, but we try to get over this matter or that matter, or to seek this fatwa, or to ask this particular sheikh, or to do this or to do that. As if we are more familiar with ourselves, we have better understanding of our nature than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, and this is not good at all. You see, we should compare this ugly matter, you know, with that bright matter. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear by the Lord of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are not going to be believers till they seek your judgment whenever there's dispute among themselves. He's not speaking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rules for worshipping Allah only. No, speaks in general about any matter, any problem between you and me and you, any dispute, any argument between father and son, between brother and brother. حتى يحكموك. They seek your judgment, you know, and all of their dispute, and they don't find even inside themselves any negative feeling, and they are going to come with full submission. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يؤمن أحدكم. He denied your belief. Denied what? Your belief. What are you without belief? Nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described these people, they are worse than the animals. No belief, worse than the animal, you are not human. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون هواه تبعا لما جئت به. Till he has his passion according to the what the Prophet wrote to us. Okay? So here is the right scale, you know, of it. Please, all of you, I'm not here to discourage you, no, of having bay'ah or having dhikr. No, I fully encourage you, but try, please, to fix all of your obligation. Try to look thoroughly, you know, to fix all of these matters, you know, to sound good that you have listened to this particular hadith which came to us, you know, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we listen, oh Allah, here we listen to you. We try to match our practice according to what you want from us. We try to get closer to you the way you want, not the way we want. Okay, and there's a significant difference between the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants and what we want, you know, because we are a mixture of different emotion and different feeling and different desires, you know, and this is not always is the way of Allah. And as you may see, when we had yesterday, you know, how Iblis or the devil, you know, try to make the person look good and nice to himself and to the others, you know, and deceive him by this matter. In the same maneuver, you know, anything, any matter in this life, Iblis has the ability to show it in a very good way, you know, for you to have some type of acceptance. And many of us, they are going to be يعني, deceived by Iblis by this way or the other way. So we should know our enemy, we should know what Allah, our Lord, wants from us, and we should go by this way. And we don't have any other way, you know, to be safe and secure except to go the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to go. So to here, nothing, don't think about anything before fixing your obligations to Allah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ولا يزال عبدي يتقرب الي بالنوافل حتى احبه. يعني my slave keep making nafila, making these optional matters, you know, of dhikr, tasbih, fasting, prayer, paying extra charity and you name it, making umrah and you name it, till I love him. When he gained the love of Allah, whenever I love him, I'm going to be his hearing whenever he hears, his sight whenever he sees, his tongue whenever he speaks, and his hand whenever he works or acts in his hand, and his foot whenever he walks on his foot. Don't ask me. This is beyond my level, beyond my imagination, but I feel that there's something great here, okay? I would look for you to have some of these matters, you know? And this is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever he loves his slave, you know? You see, these are some, not all, because in some other narration, وَلَئِن سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّ. Whenever he asked me, I'm going to give him a lot. Whenever he seeks shelter or help from me, I'm going to help him and put a shelter on him, you know. And this is all tells us about the love. The knowledgeable people in Allah, they said, even the first portion, it has its special love, you know, that people, they are not familiar with. I mean, here, the hadith spoke about the love of those who practice nafila. Besides this, you have the love of those who are good practitioners of their obligation. Are we equal in practicing our obligation? And we feel that the obligation is the same. We are going to pray Fajr 2 rak'ahs, and we are all together, and we pray Dhuhr 4 rak'ahs or 2 rak'ahs, or you name it. And we fast Ramadan, we pay our zakah, we perform Hajj. Are we equal? No, I think we are much more different, you know, in our obligation than in our nafila. Firstly, for your prayer, where is your heart? What you are thinking about, okay? Have you stuck to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ by reciting certain surah? Have you done it in very quiet way, you know, and give the ruku' its time, the sujood its time? Have you felt during ruku' that you should praise Allah in all these majestic words, you know, that you should have? Have you felt that during sujood you are the nearest one to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Have you felt during qiyam that you are facing Allah? Have you named it? Okay. So here, even though we may think that during the obligations we are equal, we have a significant difference. And the Prophet ﷺ said in one hadith, a prayer may pray, and he has of his prayer half of it, one third, one quarter, one fifth, one sixth, one seventh, one eighth, one ninth, one tenth. Alhamdulillah, the Prophet stopped there, you know. He's going to speak about people like me. He may say one in 1 million, you know, or negligible amount, or you name it, you know. He stopped at one tenth, you know, out of his mercy, Allah. So let's look about our prayer, you know, about the quality, okay? For sure, I see these nice faces, you know, none of you is going to cut down, you know, in the number of the raka'as or whatever. But let's look at the quality of our prayer, okay? And by this quality, we are going to gain, as many scholars, they say, and this is mentioned in the hadith, بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِنُ الْقَرَىٰ. And this is the most beloved thing to me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and by this we are going to gain different type of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not similar to the love that we gain from that. Okay? And that's what they say. And anyone hear about this different type of love from Allah, we should work hard, you know, to gain it, you know, because we are in real need, you know, of gaining the love of Allah. وَلَنْ تَصِلَ أَيُّهَا الطَّالِبُ إِلَى الْقِيَامِ بِأَوَامِرِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى إِلَّا بِمُرَاقَبَةِ قَلْبِكَ وَجَوَارِحِكَ فِي لَحَظَاتِكَ وَأَنْفَاسِكَ مِنْ حِينِ تُمْسِي إِلَى حِينِ تُصْبِحِ. يعني, if you want to reach this, which is holding the commands and following the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should observe and watch your heart and your organs in each moment and in each breath from evening till morning. Is this possible or impossible? It is rare, it is unusual, but it is possible and it happened to some people, okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and for sure, we are quite sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to use useless or impractical words in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. We speak here about taqwa, right? The beginning, Imam Ghazali said, we are going to speak about taqwa, the apparent one in command and prohibition. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Ali Imran, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. And the Prophet asked Sayyidina Jibreel, what's اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ? He said, الْمُطَاعَ فَلَا يُعْصَى. To obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without disobedience, and وَأَنْ يُذْكَرَ فَلَا يُنْسَى. To be in remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without forgetting Him at all. وَأَنْ يُشْكَرَ فَلَا يُكْفَرْ. And to be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time without denial of any of the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I think this, when it was put in this form, you know, about these three categories, you know, obedience and thanking and remembrance of Allah, it sounds for me that this person is going to be in charge, you know, all the time. Okay, how to do it? Let's start it. Result, the Prophet instructed us to have a moment of remembrance of Allah when you open your eyes in the morning, okay? When you wake up, you have a moment of remembrance of Allah. And when you are about to get asleep, you know, to have a moment of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the Prophet said, whoever starts his day with good matter and finish it with good matter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to tell the angels to take away everything in between. Okay? So let's start with this point. To have one moment. Okay? Then to have all those good matters, you know, we may have night prayer. We wrote about Ashraf Ummati yesterday, those who seek the night prayer in a convenient way, okay? Then, if you keep up as you do all the time, if you protect yourself, you know, of having this illegal look, you know, illegal healing, or illegal taste, you know, of some food, you know, and you name it, and then you try, as we said, to keep up with tahara purification all the time and try during prayer to be in remembrance of Allah. Try to concentrate on your prayer. By this, step by step, inshallah, you may reach some of those matters. I am personally, I believe completely in what he said, the Imam Ghazali. And I look at it as part of his experience. And he is, for me, honest man and truthful man. Even though in my practice, I feel it is impossible or almost or very far. Why I don't, no, I shouldn't say impossible. Why? Because I shouldn't be despaired of Allah. Okay? So I say, for myself, I see it too far. But I still have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy, out of His generosity, may give me, even though I don't deserve it. You know. So let's speak up about it. Let's believe in it. Okay? And let's try our best to get closer to it. The best way we know, we find, you know, to get closer to it, you know. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no doubt, is going to give us certain portion, you know, of that according to His will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى مُطَّلِعٌ عَلَى ضَمِيرِكَ وَمُشْرِفٌ عَلَى ظَاهِرِكَ وَبَاطِنِكَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of what's inside you. And He is the one who provides what is in our apparent side of you and inner side of you. وَمُحِيطٌ بِجَمِيعِ خَطَرَاتِكَ وَلَحَظَاتِكَ وَخَطَوَاتِكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lahu ihata. And that means everything is seized and surrounded by His knowledge, by His sight, by His hearing, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by many other attributes that we may not even know about them, you know. And we are in the middle, surrounded by all of these matters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in our khatarat, that means what pass through the heart. This is the khatarat. Whenever you think about a certain matter, about lahadat, when you look here or there, and about khutuwat, when you walk, and sa'ir sakanatika wa harakatik, that means all aspects of your time and of your action, in sakanat, when you are in the stage of no movement, or when you are in the stage of moving certain portion of your body. وَأَنَّكَ فِي مُخَالَطَتِكَ وَخَلَوَاتِكَ مُتَرَدِّدٌ بَيْنَ يَدَيْكَ. I say, when we sit together, or when I sit alone, you know, in a privacy in my room, you know, the same position regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that nothing has been different, you know, in this regard. Even though we tend to feel the difference, you know, now we feel that we are observed by someone or whatever, whereas at my home, I may not feel as such, but this feeling is completely wrong, you know, and this is not the case, and there's no difference, you know, regarding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my privacy or here among you. فَلَا يَسْكُنُ فِي الْمُلْكِ وَالْمَلَكُوتِ. Mulk, عالم الملك, is the world, which is physical, materialistic, felt, seen, okay, observed. Whereas al-malakut, this is the unseen, the non-physical, the one that you cannot give a definition, you know, about it, you know. And these are the two alams that we tend to speak about them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran by saying what? He said Milk and Malakut in the Quran, and in one verse he said Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Ala lahu al-khalq wal-amr. Al-khalq, this is alam al-mulk. الأمر عالم الأمر this is عالم الملكوت. Okay, we as human now, all of us, we have portion related to the creation or to the عالم الملك, and we have portion related to عالم الأمر or عالم الملكوت. Okay, if I want to be too simple, you know, with this, your body and whatever is as a need of your body, you may consider it from عالم الملك. Your soul or whatever is needed from the side of your soul is from عالم الملكوت. Okay? And we are the combination. We are not body. Okay? And this is going to be shown. When someone passed away here, he lost his body. Like when you put this, you know, you hang it, you know, in the hanger, you know. Same thing, one day you are going to hang your body, okay, and leave it. Not hang, you know, under the ground, you know. But يعني, you are going to leave away your body. But the problem, you cannot leave your soul, okay? You are going to join your soul in all the time. In عالم البرزخ, you as an identity, you are going to be soul without body. When you are gathered to the hereafter, you are going to have again combination of your body and soul, but in the opposite way. What do you mean by the opposite way? Here, in this life, we see our body. I see your face, I see your eyes, but I cannot see your soul, I cannot see your heart, I cannot see your mind. Okay? So we see the physical matters of you, and I believe that you have non-physical, and they are hidden, you know, inside you. How? Don't ask me. Okay? The other matters, the soul and what's related to soul, it's hidden, you know, inside you. And the hereafter is going to be the opposite. How? Your soul is going to be apparent, and your body is going to be hidden. Okay. What does this mean? Well, and we have trouble, you see, because if I have illegal look to a woman, or if I have illegal hearing, you know, or whatever, we are going to find on the soul a dirt, you know, a spot there, you know, and you name it. This, the spot, when I have it on my clothes or in my face, I'm going to wash it, you know. But this spot that I'm going to be faced by everyone, seen by everyone, you know, in the hereafter, how I'm going to change it or to take it away? Because it's not going to be gone by water or by soap or you name it, you know. It has its own way, you know. So here, in the hereafter, as many scholars they say, the soul is going to be shown up, okay? You may find a famous speaker, you know, about Islam, and he looks very ugly, you know, in his soul, you know, in the hereafter, you know. Even though he has very nice body, you know, and some athletic, you know, muscles and whatever, you know, and he is going to be shown very weak and very, ugly, in a very ugly way. Whereas you may find a weak person, you know, and is going to be very nice, very handsome, very beautiful, you know, because of his deeds. You know. So in the hereafter, the soul is going to be shown up, and the body is going to be hidden. Okay, and that's why they said in the hereafter, we have the ability of seeing the jinn, and the jinn they are incapable of seeing us. Why? Because in this dunya, they are more of the soul side. You know, that's why we don't see them, and we are more of the body side. That's why we are seen by them. You know. And the hereafter is going to be the opposite, and that's why we have the ability to observe them and see them, and they don't have that. So here, Al-Imam Ghazali highlights that even this may be felt broader, and it is broader, you know. The world of the soul, the world of the non-seen, the world of the non-physical, for sure is going to be in our imagination much broader, you know, than our world, you know, or whatever, but still under the control of Allah. Still, in these all areas, there are a lot of servants of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what the Prophet said. He said, "Inni ara ma la tarawn." I see something that you don't see. I hear something that you don't hear. In all heavens, you know, you don't find a space of four fingers, you know, without finding an angel putting his prostrate to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he starts speaking about these issues, you know, okay? That means even عالم الملكوت, which is unseen or non-physical for us, is under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's nowhere, you know, to go. We are Alhamdulillah about this, you know, we are under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all spaces. Alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give me even the chance to be under my control for one moment, because I'm going to destroy myself right away, you know, within one moment. Okay, so this is about عالم الملك وعالم ملكوت, or what summarized in Quran, ألا له الخلق والأمر سبحانه وتعالى. And this is, don't imagine it as separate matter, you know, it's a combination inside yourself, you know, and this combination is going to go in different stages, you know, in this life and in the hereafter. Okay. فلا يسكن في الملك والملكوت ساكن ولا يتحرك متحرك إلا وجبار السماوات والأرض مطلع عليه. يعني I have nowhere to go and hide myself without letting Allah سبحانه وتعالى knowing everything. To be more precise, Allah سبحانه وتعالى has this knowledge, you know, about me in the eternal all time. Because this knowledge of Allah is not going to be to change at all, and it's going to match exactly with what I'm going to do after one moment or after 1 hour or after 1 year. Subhanahu wa ta'ala ya'lamu kha'inat al-a'yun wa ma tukhfi as-sudur. When someone tried to give a sign, you know, for someone, you know, by his eye, this is called kha'inat al-a'yun. Why? Because he tried to deceive, not to let everyone be aware, you know, or familiar with this, and try to make it for the others. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يَنْبَغِي لِنَبِيًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمْ خَائِنَةُ أَعْيُنٍ. All prophets, they are transcendence, you know, of having such look, you know, or such a way, you know, of expression. And وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ, what's you hide in your chest or in your breast, this is all well known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ, you know subhanahu wa ta'ala your secret. وَأَخْفَى, which is more hidden than the secret. What is it? Don't ask me, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows you much more than you know about yourself. You may know your secret, but you are not going to know what is more hidden than the secret you know in your mind. فتأدب أيها المسكين ظاهرا وباطنا. What we call this, you know? What they call it in tasawwuf, this? Anyone? They call it المراقبة. This is علم المراقبة. This is one of the science or to know how to watch Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Was it mentioned in the hadith? Yes, in the Prophet said, الإحسان أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. إحسان, that's mean to worship Allah as if you observe Him سبحانه وتعالى. If you don't observe Him, be sure that He observes you. Okay, it's as simple as this. And this is called علم المراقبة. And this is, when you look at it, this is, the Prophet ﷺ call it perfection. The name is not cut, you know, name and given to this and that. No, the name match exactly. Perfection, that's mean if you want your deeds to be perfect, you know, this is the way you should keep observing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whenever you keep observing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no doubt, your work, all of your deed is going to be perfected, you know. Now, they put a supervisor, you know, and they put supervisor over the supervisor, and you name it, you know. And for sure, I have no doubt, by this way, they improved a lot, you know, in this field, you know, in this field. That's why in developing countries like our countries, we don't improve, you know, because we don't have supervisor, we don't have anyone, you know, and everyone has his own free time. Here they have some observers on you, some to control what you are doing, you know, and some who is going to write down whatever. And by this, they improved a lot. I cannot deny it, you know, okay? So here, but even in this setting, you know, whenever this supervisor is busy or sick or not looking at you, you are going to fight three times in order to do whatever you want. Okay? Here, the Muslim, the real Muslim, is supervisor. There's no interruption. Always looking at him, always observing him. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ told us. فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاهُ. By this, you are going to be perfect in all of your aspects. Okay? Because you are in real thinking, you know, or real belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala observes you in all aspects of your life. And this is the best way of perfection. فتأدب أيها المسكين ظاهرا وباطنا بين يدي الله. Okay. We speak about etiquette, we speak about adab, we speak about behavior, you know, and we try to fix it toward everyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We tend to forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here, Imam Ghazali wants us to go back and has look at the original matter of us, you know. When I was hidden in the belly of my mother, who was taking care of me? Who was looking at me? Who was observing me? You know, no one except Allah. When I left, you know, my grave, who's going to take care of me? This is just to make it يعني, closer to our thinking, you know, but the reality, even now, you know, we are sitting, even though you are observed by me or by this or that, you know, no one knows what's going on in your body. Let's leave the soul. No one knows what's going on inside your body exactly except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the reality in all times, in all moments, you know, in all stages, and you name it, no one is familiar or knows about you except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here, Imam Ghazali said, تأدب أيها المسكين. You are very poor and very useless person. That's why he's called you miskin. Why? Because when you look at the reality, you are observed by Allah, who has all perfect attributes and perfect name, which we know and which we don't know. And I may have gone here, you know, and I may have a tricky way in my mind, and I may have this, but I am too poor and too useless, you know, and this is not going to be helpful for me. And by this, be sure all of us, you know, one day by this, we are going to be gone away and that. Okay? So, no protection, nothing, you know, we are full, with full surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we should enjoy this time, okay? Because of your full surrender. That's why in Tasawwuf they describe if you want to be a real slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should feel yourself as if you are dead body in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Regardless if you feel it or not, this is the case. This is the reality. So it's better to be. So that's why we call you al-miskeen, because you are out of everything, you know, you cannot give benefit to anyone besides yourself, and you cannot protect anyone besides yourself. تأدب تأدب العبد الذليل المذنب. You are slave. You are what you call ذليل, the humiliated or humble. Okay, and you are مذنب. That you have a lot of sins في حضرة الجبار القهار. Many of us, we don't like to hear these attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though we believe that they are right. Okay, but we would like to have the jamali, the beauty more than the jalali, the majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But are we in need of this or not? We are in need, okay? And sometimes we should have different way of looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in different attributes, in different names, you know? We should enrich our heart of fearing of Allah and knowing Allah and loving Allah. And there's no controversy in this regard, you know? The one who gets the maximum of Allah, of all of his attributes, of all of his Holy Name is the most knowledgeable person in Allah. And that's why you see the prophets, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were in their life, you know, they have some disaster, they have some negative outcome, you know, or unhappy events, you know. And as a matter of fact, as the Prophet said, أَشَدُّكُمْ بَلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءَ, the most who are going to be tested and tempted, you know, by these matters, they are the prophets. You know. Why? Because Allah doesn't love them? No. Allah loves them a lot. But this is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants them to know Allah by all of His attributes and all of His holy name. Those who just look at Allah from the beauty side, they have very significant lack of knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Those the prophets, they have the perfect knowledge, you know, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why we are in need sometimes to have a lot, you know, or to know the attributes or the holy names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the jalali side, not from the jamali side. وَاجْتَهِدْ أَلَّا يَرَاكَ مَوْلَاكَ حَيْثُ نَهَاكَ. Work hard not to be seen where you shouldn't be seen by your Lord or by your Master. وَلَا يَفْقُدُكَ حَيْثُ أَمَرَكَ, and not to be absent wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be present. See, when they show the names of fasting people, you know it's faster. Are you available or are you away? When they show the names of those who attended Jum'ah prayer, are you among them or are you away? When they show the name about those who performed Salatul Fajr, are you among them or are you still sleeping? You see, here you should observe yourself about all of these matters. ولن تقدر على ذلك إلا بأن توزع أوقاتك وترتب أورادك من صباحك إلى مساء. You should be well organized. The good Muslim practitioner is the most one to be organized in this life. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divided his time and have a reminder for all activities, you know. He has Fajr prayer, he has Dhuhr prayer, and you name it, you know. And that this, when this makes you organized and well oriented about the time, okay. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also wants you to be well oriented about your place, because you should look at Qibla direction, and you should be well oriented about your heart, because you are going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Muslim who are really knows what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants of him from this life, you know, is the most oriented one, is the most organized person, you know. And really we need this organization, you know, because we have short period of time and we have a lot of duty to do. Okay, that's why we need to be familiar with these matters. We should know how to organize our time, organize ourselves, organize our orders. And we should know the priority. What comes first, what comes later, what comes at end, okay? If I may not do it, you know, but this is the reality. If I did not eat today, I'm not going to die, you know. I may eat tomorrow, you know. I may catch up, you know, tomorrow and eat, you know. If I did not sleep well today, I have tomorrow. If not tomorrow, I have a time, you know, in the grave, I'm going to sleep for a long time, you know. And this is not going to be, yani, gone away, and I'm going to find it, you know. But we have something, you know, when I miss Fajr prayer at the sunrise, I say, okay, they mention, you know, the scholars, they mention, even if I wake up, you know, and make it, you know, that's it. Yani, this is similar to if it's done in the time. But they said we missed the maximum of that time. That if you kept praying till the end of your life, you are not going to get what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spread in that particular time. When you miss one day fasting, this mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if you fast for the rest of your life, you are not going to get what you missed. See? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put this time, it's not a matter of praying. Here you have reality. In this particular time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designated or have predestination of certain matter that is going to happen at this time, you know, those people who are standing asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are going to be given something, you know, and if you miss this, you know, even though the scholar will tell you to make up your prayer and tell you you may be excused or this or that, but you miss something, you know, of that prayer, you know, that you're not going to come up with. Okay? Even the Prophet mentioned one hadith, a person may pray the prayer and what he missed of the time. It sounded as if he's still inside the time, you know, of Fajr prayer. What he missed of this time, this is not going to be reached by him again at all. It's mentioned by the Prophet. And even sometimes when we pray that the prayer at the time, you know, you miss the significance of that particular prayer. So we need organization in this regard because, generally speaking, we are in time of business. All of us, we are busy. We give this life much more than what it deserves. We spend a lot of time in this life, studying, working, having social relation, having this, having that, okay? So the one who wants to live this life, he should organize himself. Otherwise, he's going to miss many duties, many rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on his name. فأصل إلى ما يلقى إليك الدوام إذا تعلم حين تستيقظ من منامك إلى وقت رجوعك إلى مرجعك. He's going to summarize for us آداب السنة النبوية from the beginning when we wake up till the end of the day. إن شاء الله after the break we'll start speaking about them, you know. This we may not go in detail, you know, these, most of them, they are certain actions, they are certain azkar. Firstly, you know, you may have a copy of them and put it next to your bed and try to apply it to your life on a daily basis, okay? And when you memorize them and get used to them, this is going to be good, inshallah, as a good start, you know, not the end, good start. So we'll speak about them, inshallah, shortly after 10 minutes of break.